Earlier. I'm joined now from Melbourne by the Assistant Defence Minister, Stuart Robert. Before we get on to other matters, I do want to ask you about this Ebola crisis. Labor says the government should be doing more. Stuart Robert, they've cited the AMA, the UN and President Obama in terms of the response here. Is there any capacity for Australia to be sending in our experts in the field?
Well, the Foreign Minister's made it very clear, Kieran, that at present we've provided an extra $10 million to assist the effort in Africa, but there's no point actually putting some of our health workers in there unless we have a plan to effectively be able to get them out if indeed there is an infection. And the Foreign Minister's made it very clear that the responsible course of action is to ensure we have a capacity to move people out before we move people in.
Let's look at the ISIL threat now. Some fears Australian commandos might arrive too late to boost the Iraqi forces. What's your latest advice on the ISIL threat as we speak?
Well, we're working through the documentation required for the Status of Forces Agreement for our forces to advise and assist the Iraqi counter-terrorism service within Iraq. Our job there is not to fight. We're not providing ground troops. We're providing advisers. We're providing special forces to assist their troops to re-engage and get back in the fight. This war will be won on the ground. It'll be won on the ground by the Iraqi forces. The air campaign is designed to create space to allow the Iraqi forces to move north and regain the initiative. We're certainly in a difficult time. There's no question about that. The Iraqi forces are fighting well, especially around Ramadi, where they're taking substantial casualties, but certainly holding ground in some quarters. As soon as we can get that documentation underway, we can get our people in there to advise and assist. But there's a long way to go in this fight left, Kieran.
Yeah, well, General John Allen says it's going to be a slow and lengthy process. That was his advice at the State Department this morning. It does look like it is going to be a long battle indeed. Certainly as the ISIL militants start immersing themselves in the community, it's much harder, obviously, to take them on in that context.
Well, there's no question, as soon as air assets came into theatre, ISIL stopped using its heavy weapons and moving openly across the ground. They'll now do what normal counterinsurgency forces do, use technicals, pick up trucks with weapon systems, women and children in the back, and immerse themselves in population areas. Makes it very difficult to target, which is why the air campaign is about creating space and why this is won on the ground by the Iraqi forces. So it will take time. We're looking forward to getting our forces into Iraq to advise and assist to get the Iraqi forces moving north. But the Prime Minister's made it very clear this will take some months.
I want to turn now to the submarine capacity. A number of your Liberal colleagues, senators, including former Defence officer himself, David Fawcett, suggesting that the government needs to put out to tender the submarine contract, not to simply buy them off the shelf from Japan. Will the government, will Defence heed this advice from some of your own colleagues here?
Well, Senator Fawcett is a very fine, credentialed former military officer. He's a great friend of mine, and he's a great stalwart for South Australia. And his job as a South Australian senator is to advocate strongly for South Australia. And I think he's doing a superb job, and South Australians should be proud of him. But we're jumping the gun a little. We're 6 months away from completing our analysis in terms of what the options are. Senator Johnson is in Japan now, having a dialogue with new Minister Ito. Of course, dialogues have also occurred with European countries. Our design teams are looking at what the options are, whether the options are to have an evolved design of the Collins, a new design, or something off the shelf. And in 6 months' time, government will receive that advice. Now, I know there's a lot of posturing going on from a lot of states and a lot of quarters, but everyone just needs to be patient and let this design work run its course. Now, it would be helpful if this had been done over the 6 years of the previous administration, but it wasn't. So once again, we're left a disaster to fix up, and we're working through it methodically, slowly and carefully.
David Fawcett says that Australia needs to maintain a sovereign engineering capability. He says essentially we need that to conduct the maintenance and certification activities throughout the whole life of the submarine. So while he obviously might have that parochial South Australian view, he's also making this case on a defence and sovereign basis as well.
Well, Senator Fawcett, of course, was, I think, Army's first commanding officer of a RAF unit in South Australia that did the test and evaluation of aircraft. So he's certainly well-credentialed to speak on this. And the point he's making, of course, is that we spend about $1 billion per annum maintaining and sustaining our current Collins-class fleet that's doing exceptionally well, can I say, in terms of the work that it's doing now that we've been able to remediate the problems. So we need to be able to continue to do that sustainment and that maintenance. And as the Prime Minister has made very clear, any new submarine procurement will, of course, centre around those same ship docks that we're using in South Australia.
I know that last week, on to another issue, you were at the US-American leadership dialogue, American-Australia leadership dialogue, and received briefings at the Pacific Command in Hawaii. Tell me, in terms of the rebalance that we heard a lot about from President Obama, is that a threat because of the so-called sequestration of the US budget, the fact that there are going to be cuts to the military and that might have an impact in our region as well?
There's no question that Obama's strategy for rebalance to move 60% of US combat power into the most Pacific area, the Indo-Pacific, still remains the number one priority for Pacific Command. The challenge for sequestration, of course, is unless the US can get a budget deal through Congress, their automatic budget cuts come down. Now, those cuts, I think, will be felt more through Central Command, through European and Africa Command, more so than they will in terms of Pacific Command. But as we approach 2020, unless Congress can deal more effectively with these budget issues, there may certainly be some challenges ahead.
And finally, I want to ask you about an exercise, a joint military drill at the weekend between Australian, US and Chinese personnel. Interesting, of course, we know that we have many exercises, including the enormous Talisman Sabre exercise with the US, but involving China, this at a time when, of course, there are great sensitivities in both the East and South China Sea, Minister.
There are. Exercise Quarry, which is named after a small Northern Territory grizzly grey rodent, apparently, is a fabulous trilateral exercise where for the first time we have Chinese combat troops, Chinese troops from the People's Liberation Army, 10 of them, 10 of our troops, 5 Marines and 5 US Army on a survival exercise. So everyone's starving themselves out there. And the intent is to learn more about surviving in the very arid and rugged part of Northern Australia. And of course, after that, the team can spend some downtime together in Darwin. So I'm just thrilled that the Marines, the US Army, our troops, and Chinese troops, together with our Aboriginal soldiers from Norforce, can train together. And I think it sends a fabulous message for our region.
Minister, thanks for your time this morning. Appreciate it.
Pleasure. Great to talk to you, Kieran.